Yeah, I've been rehearsing the band right now, actually, for a while, and we're supposed to go on the road, like, before the end of the year.
Mm-hmm. Who is we? Who are you bringing along?
Oh, who am I bringing along? Well, I got a drummer. My drummer's Paul Garisto, who played on Iggy Pop's last album and the last tour. Mm-hmm. And before that, I think he played with Psychedelic first, you know.
Right.
And on bass, I have a guy called J.D. Mallow. J.D. has played with Smashed Gladys, if you've ever heard of the band.
The New York band.
And then around anymore, I think. But anyways, these are the young kids, you know, I know. They're not the same guys who play on the record, but John Sierra on guitar.
Little Steven won't come along? You can't drag him out? You think you can drag Little Steven out to go
along? Oh, wow, that would be great. Yeah, that would be cool. I don't know. How about it, Steven? That'll be cool. Well, maybe we'll have little Steven on the next video. You know?
There you go. That'll be cool.
Yeah, that would be cool. You know.
All right. So when is this gonna start?
Well, we're supposed to do a thing in Japan for New Year's, mm-hmm. and before that we're probably gonna do a few gigs like maybe New York and LA and stuff.
Right.
We're planning to do a club day tour, but right now nobody knows who the hell I am.
Oh, we'll take care of that, don't worry. You just tell us when you're gonna play and we'll take care of the rest. Man, it was good seeing you. Thanks
good
for dropping
you.
By.
Nice being here.
Good luck.
Right,
and we'll finish this hour off with Megadeth, of course. No more Mr. Nice Guy.
No more.
The disregard of timekeeping from Bonham, Cocked and Loaded from LA Guns is number 9. Number 8 is Faster Pussycats, Wake Me When It's Over. Conspiracy from King Diamond is number 7. Number 6 is Trash from Alice Cooper. Number 5 is Dirty, Rotten, Filthy, Stinkin' Rich from Warrant. Skid Row's first album is number 4. Number 3 is Practice What You Preach from Testament. Aerosmith's Pump is number 2. And the number 1 album on the concrete chart, as well as the number 1 album in the country, is Dr. Feelgood from Motley Crue. Right now, let's rip and tear back into the videos with LA Guns. Time for it for tonight. Babylon AD are ready to hit you with their East Bay rock invasion. Hailing from what seems to be the new hot rock bed, Babylon AD have a straight-ahead rock attack. They stir up their authentic pounding on their self-titled debut with a twin guitar chord attack and melodic harmonies. Songs include Bang Go the Bells, Marianne, Hammer Swings Down, which will be the first video, and The Kid Goes Wild with a special guest vocalist, screamer, comedian Sam Kinison. Babylon AD also have a few ballads called Desperate and the twangy blues rocker Sally Dance. And there's more new blood kicking and clawing its path into the ranks of the metal scene. This band goes by the name Cats in Boots and features 2 American and 2 Japanese members. On their debut album, Kicked and Clawed, the band combines their East meets West mix with some hard, rockin' dirty raunch and roll. They've also got a blues connection reminiscent of the way Aerosmith and Motley Crue have been influenced. The first track on the album, Shotgun Sally, rocks out, as does the cuts 9 Lives, Save Me, Coast to Coast, Bad Boys, and Judas Kiss, which has some great harmonica on it. Other tracks to look for are the slinky blues rocker Whip It Out, the melodic finger-picking ballad Every Sunrise, and the all-out attack of Heaven on a Heartbeat. And right now we have the debut for you of Shotgun Sally.
Shotgun Sally, you're out of here.
Between the 5 of us, we have quite a varied musical collection, really.
Yeah, everything from, you know, rock and metal to soundtracks, classical music,
jazz.
I mean, it's a lot of, we try and, you know, we spend so much time on Queensryche and trying, you know, working on our songs and performing that it's real refreshing to exit that. You know, and for our sanity, I think, at times, you know, to play just something that's, you know, you really doesn't have the same sort of intensity, I think.
Oh!
Hey! I'm Vince Neil.
Hey, I'm Tommy.
And, of course, we are Motley Crue.
And we're back for more Hard 30. Today you'll see videos from Tesla,
Skid Row,
Giant,
And Rad with Back for More. You guys, you and Nikki were in this video, weren't you?
Yeah, we were cops from hell, so check this out. Back for More. Ooh.
Hey everybody, this is Ted Poley
and Andy Timmons from
Danger, Danger Danger.
And if you need a little danger,
get it on Hard 30.
Oh man.
We're back.
Yeah, we're back. Hold on. Come on. Oh, yes.
Aww.
Oh, yes.
Ooh.
Well, Tommy Lee, by one.
Here's a video by some buds of ours, Skid Row, Sebastian. He came over and trashed my house the other night. Thank you very much, dude.
They're going on tour with us in Europe. We start in Germany with them in a few days.
And we just saw this video just a little while ago.
It's pretty cool.
It is a great video. It was filmed at the Country Club in Los Angeles. And it's called Piece of Me.
Tommy Lee down by one.
The Vince Neil ball. Actually,
no,
right
we're,
here.
We're tied.
Yeah, we are tied.
We are tied.
We'll play at the end of this. Well, we're just about over, dude. This is about it.
For
and
today.
This game's just about over with.
But that's just for today, because we'll be back tomorrow for more videos from Mr. Big.
Extreme.
The Stage Dolls.
And here's one from Giant with I'm a Believer. And I believe I'm gonna win this game.
I doubt it.
Come on.
Well, that's it for the crew in today's Hard 30.
But we'll see you tomorrow. Dr. Dre and Ed Lover are next with
Yo MTV Raps.
It's great.
It's choice.
Yeah, this is something that we've strive for the last 10 years, you know, and we got real close with Girls, Girls, Girls. That came in at, you know, I peaked at number two, and, you know, that was, like, really cool, but it wasn't, like, cool enough, and finally, like, a number one album. It's, like, everybody's, like, so jazzed, and it happened on Tommy's birthday.
Yeah, the record, record company calls me up and goes, T-Bone? Yeah, I go, yeah. They go, you sitting down? I go, yeah, why? What's wrong? You go, your record just went number one. I just, yeah. Hung up the phone. Oh, it's great, man. What a rush.
Well, we're back, and I'm still Vince.
And I'm still Tommy.
And we are still Motley Crue, and today is hump day for anybody who hasn't noticed by now.
Yes, we're halfway there. Let's check out videos from Mr. Big, the Stage Dolls.
And we're even going to play Dr. Feelgood for you. Let's get things started, though, right now with Mother from Extreme.
I'm Chips Enough. Everybody needs a Hard 30.
Don't you?
And we are back. The Hard 30 returns. What do you want to watch, dude?
I want to see Dr. Feelgood.
Me too, man. Here we go. Well, dude, we're at the end of hump day.
One more left.
No, two more. We'll be here at the end of the week, man.
Oh, man, I wish this show was longer. This is too short.
But we're back on the Hard 30, and we're going to be back again tomorrow with some more videos for you.
From The Cult.
Yeah,
Faster Pussycat.
Alice Cooper. And until then, here's a debut from The Stage Dolls. And this is Still in Love.
Don't look at me when you say that.
Still in love again. That's it for today's Hard 30.
We'll see you tomorrow. Stay right where you are.
For Yo MTV Rap.
Well, we're back again. I'm Vince.
I'm Tommy.
And we're still Motley Crue. 3 down, 2 to go. And we got a bunch of cool videos for you today. We got Metallica,
Faster Pussycat, and The Cult.
Yeah, and we started off with a little Alice Cooper and Poison. Well, the Hard 30 continues. What should we watch?
Well, here's one. Here's one from Metallica. Here's one from Metallica.
Here's one from Metallica.
Here's one from Metallica.
Oh, here's one from Metallica. One.
This time we approached it that, you know, we kind of wanted to do it ourselves and
just
beat
the band.
Just the band in it, because the other videos we had, you know.
I mean, every video's got girls in them, and I was parading around showing cleavage. I'm not saying our next video won't have that, but this video right now, you know, we wanted, even though it's, you know, about a girl, you know, we just felt like, let's just do the band. Let's just have performance.
It's more comfortable. I mean, that's what we do. You know, we can't really go out there and act it out.
Our 30 in our careers.
Oh, man. Well, I guess we're out of here.
This is Vince and Tommy signing off from Motley Crue. Yo, MTV Raps is next!
Oh!
Yo.
To a diatribe about all the media flack he's been getting for his lyrics to the now notorious Guns N' Roses album track One in a Million, with its pot shots at, quote, immigrants, faggots, and niggers, unquote. I'm sick and tired of all this publicity, Rose said, before tearing into an hour-long set. Then when the group returned for an encore, Rose announced, quote, unless certain people in this band start getting their act together, this is going to be the last Guns N' Roses show. I'm sick and tired of too many people in this organization dancing with Mr. Brownstone, a reference to a drug song on the band's debut album. The sold-out crowd, which included Bruce Springsteen, Tom Waits, and tennis star John McEnroe, was suitably stunned by this outburst. And the next day, nobody was really certain whether or not the band would show up to play the second show of the Stones' four-night stand. In the end, though, they did. Axl Rose apologized for his previous night's rant. Guitarist Slash stepped to the mic and emphasized that Guns N' Roses is against drugs. And for the moment, at least, all seemed to be well. We'll definitely keep you posted, though. Meanwhile, a less troubled group, U2.
When I've written a song that's come very, very fast, that you would normally call inspiration, it's usually a dream that's reoccurred. It's something I've dreamt, and it just popped back into my consciousness again, and bam, I'm writing it. And I'm thinking, wow, this is very inspired. But I figured it out. That's what it is. It's something I've dreamt.
Harry Truman, Doris Day, Regina, Johnny Ray, South Pacific, Walter Winchell, Joe DiMaggio.
Sometimes when I'm trying to develop a song, I talk to a lot of people about emotions and things they're going through and this and that, trying to put my own head together on how I feel about something. So the product doesn't just come from me. It comes from a lot of people, everybody I talk to.
Idea is just to, I think, to humanize it and demystify the process a little bit and just show people that, you know, we're just, I'll speak for myself, I'm just a bozo, I just happen to write songs, you know, it's just something I do, it's, and I think it's something that a lot of folks can do and do well.
I love Whitesnake. My friend Cyndi Lauper, I always think is wonderful. I admire Madonna, she's a pal of mine too, and she's really smart. I'd like to work with Stevie Ray Vaughan. He's not weird. He's a nice guy and talented.
But none of that means Minnelli is up on the latest recording technology. In fact, being in the Pet Shop Boys' state-of-the-art studio was a real learning experience for her.
You know, it surprised me that there was nobody alive playing on the album. It was all machines. Everything, but I was fascinated on how they built the track. You know, what it would start with and what they'd add and what they, when they decide to add it. And it was just so complicated. And they're so good at it, and Chris is so clever.
We really like it, which is the most important thing, but if you're working with someone else, it can't be a purely business or something. I mean, we actually like her a lot.
It was the dark, ironic attitude of the Pet Shop Boys' 1987 song, Rent, that first attracted Liza to them. And you can hear those same qualities in the first single and video from the LP, Losing My Mind. Or am I losing my mind? Liza and the Pet Shop Boys. How successful the combination is remains to be seen. But as far as going out on a limb and taking a chance, Minnelli's already scored some points.
It's a pretty far out combination, but the truth of it, which is the music of it, is the part that works, and that's all that you really care about. Whatever works, you do.
With Liza Minnelli shedding her Vegas image and such other lounge land kingpins as Frankie and Sammy and Dino getting on in years, who's left to carry on this very American tradition of boozy bad taste and showbiz insincerity? Well, we have the answer to that question, an act that's been knocking them dead and down.
The suspects. Interrogation of the witnesses.
There's a revolution. That's all I know.
Mind crime?
Who killed Mary?
You'll have to find out for yourself.
Queensryche solve the mind crime contest. One winner and guest will be flown to a mystery location equipped with leather tour jackets and a full dossier, including autographed copies of Exhibit A, Video Mind Crime. It will be your duty to interrogate Queensryche for 48 hours. You may even have to be the first to hear the new Queensryche LP. Five runners-up will walk off with Queensryche tour jackets, and 25 others will milk the system for the autographed Video Mind Crime. Send a postcard with your name, address, age, and phone number to Queensryche Solve the Mind Crime Contest, MTV, 1775 Broadway, 10th floor, New York, New York, 10019.
Help Headbangers Ball take a bite out of mind crime.
This MTV contest sponsored by Barks Root Beer.
Yo MTV Raps is sponsored.
Hi, I'm Chris DeGarmo.
And Jeff Tate from Queensryche. Welcome back to the Headbangers Ball.
And here's DAD with Sleeping My Day Away. In news.
You know, a couple of weeks ago, they called us and said they wanted us to come out to Red Rocks, Colorado to do a show, and they were going to film the audience for this film that's going on, which stars Vince Neil. And we had the opportunity to meet Vince Neil backstage, very nice. And it was amazing how he introduced himself. It went something like, somebody said, "Vince, this is Jeff Tate from Queensryche," and he goes, "Hey, yeah, right, how are you?" And then there was... "Vince, this is Chris DeGarmo from Queensryche." "Hey, yeah, right, how are you?" Anyway, here's Motley Crue with Dr. Feelgood. In about 15 minutes, you'll see the world premiere of our new video, Speak.
But right now, it's Poison from Alice Cooper. I'm Chris DeGarmo.
And Jeff Tate from Queensryche. And we're back for the second hour of Headbangers Ball. Videos are on the way from Skid Row, Badlands, Fate's Warning, and Dangerous Toys.
But tonight's a very special segment, you see, because tonight we've coupled the broadcast with a very special transmission that's a very highly sophisticated, invisible, and harmless cathode ray beam aimed directly at you, the viewer's cerebral cortex. But don't worry, kids, that's Pig Latin for fun, fun, fun here on Headbangers Ball.
Anyway, here's the world premiere of our new video, Speak.
Let the sun
On the Headbangers Ball, here is a band called Dangerous Toys and the song Scared.
Dedicated to Alice Cooper.
Alice. Back for more of the Headbangers Ball.
Right now we're going to play a band that old friends of ours opened up a show, I think, for us in way back in 1983 in Hartford, Connecticut.
And this is from their new album, Perfect Symmetry. It's Fate's Warning with Through Different Eyes.
Hi. Up next, we've got a band that got their name from an old logging road that was in Seattle hundreds of years ago. I bet they probably don't even know that.
Probably not.
Anyway, Skid Row with Piece of Me.
Oh, the Headbangers Ball.
We're back.
We've reached the third and final hour of the Headbangers Ball, and you'll see videos from Megadeth, Michael Monroe, Iron Maiden, and Testament.
If you missed it before, make sure you find out how you can get a chance to solve our video mind crime. Details are coming up. Right now, here's Aerosmith with Love in an Elevator. Personal experience, I believe.
Steven Tyler's, yes.
All right, up next we've got the first video we released from our Operation Mindcrime album.
And actually that was the first video that started a chain of events which turned into more videos and eventually has wound up now in a home video compilation that we've aptly titled Video Mindcrime. It consists of 9 different segments, 6 major video pieces off the Operation Mindcrime story, and it's available now.
Everywhere.
Yeah, this is one of the tracks off it. As Jeff said, the first video we made for the album, Eyes of a Stranger.
Looking back at me.
it's Headbangers Ball. Next, we've got a song that's a cover tune of Alice Cooper's No More Mr. Nice Guy, aptly done by Dave Mustaine and Megadeth.
And as a matter of fact, Mr. Mustaine will be here on Halloween when Alice Cooper takes over the Headbangers Ball.
So here it is. The Headbangers Ball continues with Michael Monroe.
Yes, and the next video we're about to see actually has a supposedly accidental appearance by Axl who?
Axl
Rose. Here's Dead, Jail, or Rock and Roll. Well, the ball is just about over for tonight, but remember, get those postcards in the mail to enter our Solve the Mind Crime contest.
Yes, and the last video is from Rock's Gang. It's called Scratch My Back.
Her album, and I kind of had the idea. It's about like a liquor-induced nightmare. And, you know, it's more or less like a kid, though, kind of like a kid. Or it could be even me, like becoming a part of Alice Cooper's stage show back when he, you know, he used to use the guillotines. I think he still uses that stuff, too. And the guillotines and the monsters and that whole Alice Cooper show era between like 71 and 78, you know, he was just really wild. And that's kind of, I kind of incorporated all of that in the song Scared.
Headbangers Ball continues on through the night. Adam Curry is still with you, and along with me, special guest this evening from EZO, we have Taro Masaki.
Hi, how are you doing?
Fine, how are you guys doing?
Great, welcome. It's been great.
Welcome to the Headbangers Ball. Since the last time you guys toured in the States, you've relocated to Hoboken, New Jersey.
Right.
But first of all places, Hoboken. This is interesting. Why did you choose to come live in the States, and why Hoboken?
So New York is pretty expensive to live, and Hoboken is much cheaper.
Yeah. Yeah, and yeah. We really love staying in New York, but we feel sometimes it's too much. So. Yeah.
Maybe we should explain that Hoboken is like, you know, 10 minutes through the tunnel.
10 minutes.
Right.
Yeah.
And fast train, you know.
There are lots of yuppie people now.
Well, was it a culture shock to come over and live in the States?
Yeah. I was like, oh my God, you know.
Yeah. what was like the hardest thing to adjust
thing?
To?
Speaking English.
Yeah. Well, you don't have any problem with it. You speak
right
fluent.
Now. Like we have lots of friends, like with party hanging around, and we have like an English teacher, you know. Mm-hmm. So I was taking English lesson every day. So we got better and better. It's hard first time, you know. I couldn't say. We couldn't say anything. We couldn't buy a cigarette, you know.
No, really. Well, you guys are doing okay.
Yeah.
Tell me, what is the metal scene like in Japan? Is it? I've never been there, so I have no idea.
That's like there are very many bands in now, and like as far as this kind of music, kids really into it. And this like 3 years, 4 years. After success of Bon Jovi, Whitesnake, Guns N' Roses, whoever, then the market is getting bigger, bigger, bigger.
Mm-hmm. You guys have gone through a little change, no more makeup, since this new album. Have you taken a new musical direction as well?
No, basically it's same. Like we always just like create our music, and we love doing this.
Yeah, just play what we want all the time. Mm-hmm. Like, don't be not so much image, just be myself. That's an important thing.
Like, but we'd been wearing the makeup for like 6 years. So
yeah.
And the last year we decided no more, sick of it.
Yeah.
There you go. Mm-hmm.
No more hustle.
Yeah, here you are on that. We'll talk more, hang out with us for a little bit longer if you want.
Right, sure.
We got a video for you right now. Fate's Warning, this is Through Different Eyes. Zio, and your new album is Fire,
right?
Which is kind of ironic because from what I hear, and we've been reporting these stories, you guys have had a couple of close encounters with fire.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, the tour bus.
Yeah.
Tell me this story. What exactly happened?
It was probably 2 months ago when we played in Philadelphia, and when we went back home in the middle of the highway, the tour bus got fired. And
like engine starts smelling with smell fire. What's happening like that?
Yeah, and that's what I would have said too.
What's up? Like smoke came out, and then we get out the bus, like, and then we found like a smoke all around the place, you know.
Oh, like black smoke all over the bus.
So was the bus destroyed or?
And we start pushing
the fire extinguisher. And I didn't walk like this big, so. And we jumped out and after that for 2 hours, we are watching like this.
Yeah, whole fire, big fire, like San Francisco or something.
Really?
Happened,
wow. You know? Now, and something similar happened in San Jose, I believe.
Yeah,
we played there. We were staying in like a kind of motel, right? In the one house really close to the motel. Got the fire, like a huge house, just burned up.
You guys like accident prone. Do I smell smoke in here? Or is it my imagination? How about in your video? Any bad things happen with fire when?
No, fortunately.
How did the video shoot go? Because we're about to roll it, by the way.
Yeah, we shot this one in the New York Palladium disco.
Sure.
And we wanted to get like a basic performance video this time. And we really liked this one.
Okay. Yeah, make it simple.
Mm-hmm. And here it comes on the Headbangers Ball, EZO, Million Miles Away. Writing lyrics, do you write them in Japanese first and then translate them into English, or because I don't know, because you know, I come from a different country and it, you know, I had to for a while I had to translate things from Dutch into English. How does it work for you?
So I think in English right now,
yeah,
because of I live here 3 years and then I can't think in English. I dream in English, I just, like talking in the sleep, you know, in English.
Now so, wait a minute, how do you know you talk English in your sleep? Who told you that?
My girlfriend.
Okay.
Well, Taro told me, you know.
Yeah, right.
I speak a lot in my sleep, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, loud.
So for my lyrics, like, I have friends. His name is Jody Gray.
Mm-hmm.
And he's really good friend of mine. And we sit down together a couple of times, like a whole day long. We eat lunch, like a spicy food or Indian food or like a Chinese food. And then we write down on the paper, talk about it.
Right.
And then like make it like a more natural English, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Originally, like every lyrics came from like from me or from Taro or from band, think about it. And then translating like more proper lyrics, you know.
Right. Now, you also had some help on the album from a couple of well-known guys.
Right.
I see where you have Chris Gates, David Roach from Junkyard.
Yeah. Yeah.
How'd you do
on the Geffen record.
Oh, is that is it a label thing that...
The Geffen A&R guy, Mio Vukovic, he's a great guy.
Yeah.
He brought like two guys from Junkyard to New York. And we kind of jammed in the back of the studio. And we wrote two songs with them. And it was a great experience because they are basically from like Texas, South Texas, and they got like a certain influence from blues, we don't have anything like that. So it was really interesting.
But together it does make an interesting combination.
Yeah.
Before I let you guys go, tour plans, what's in the works for EZO?
24th, we played in New Jersey, and we're gonna play in North Carolina, and after that we go to Los Angeles, I mean, West Coast, Texas again.
Everywhere, all over the country.
How often do you get back home to Japan?
We haven't went back for about two years
yeah.
and a half. We miss our families, friends, but we love living in here. So.
Well, I'll tell you what, since the Headbangers Ball is shown in Japan, why don't you guys say something to the folks back home? And you can do it in Japanese.
All right.
Just keep it clean.
So we are easier, and we are in Hoboken now, and we are playing in the United States for probably until the end of this year. Then next year we're gonna go back.
All right, now say hi to your mom. Just say something in Japanese. I just gotta hear
it.
I believe it. All right, guys. Thanks a lot for dropping by tonight.
All right.
No problem.
Good to see you. Good luck. Come by when when you got some
thank
more
you.
To tell us about
thank
the tour
you.
Or whatever.
Okay. Yeah, thanks a lot.
And we're going to leave you right now with Queensryche. Here's Breaking the Silence. It is a debut. Were you around when the quake hit?
No, we weren't around, luckily. But we're in Atlanta, actually, the night it hit. We were just going to play a show with Bang Tango. We're just ready to go on stage. We're all psyched up to play. And it was about a minute before we were going on, and we were on our bus, and he was watching the start of the World Series, and they announced it. Mm-hmm. And it was just like, we just went, and it just seemed like the whole place was devastated because they didn't really give any details. Mm-hmm. We were like, are we going to go on or what? And our manager lives like right in the Haight-Ashbury, and so many of our friends, we were a little scared at first, but we said, hey, we got to play. So we just said, let's forget about it. And if our manager's even half alive, she's going to want us to play. So we went out there and just played. And it was a good show because one of the stagehands made a comment, just because their city got destroyed didn't mean they had to destroy our town.
Yeah, that's true. Besides earthquakes, Bay Area is known for a lot of thrash bands.
Yeah.
Was it hard for you guys to get gigs in the beginning in the area, or?
No, it wasn't really that hard. It was like a little bit different at first because, you know, there were some bands that were like us playing, you know, like Jet Boyd played and then they'd move to LA, but it's mostly thrash, but our music was a lot heavier. So even if someone saw a picture of us and we didn't really have a thrash look or anything, you know, they'd come check it out because they heard we could play guitars and we were a hard rock band.
Right.
So in some of our first gigs and the big clubs were like with Guns N' Roses and Poison and
right.
stuff. So we had some pretty good first shots and cherry bombs.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then, you know, people, you know, heard about that we were a heavy metal band. There was lots of girls at our show. We had guys from Testament and, you know,
cool.
all the thrash bands hanging out at all our shows anyway. So,
Ashley, were you ever tempted to move south to LA at all?
We thought about it, but then we had built up such a loyal following in, you know, the Bay Area, we didn't want to abandon them because we had seen what other bands had done.
Mm-hmm.
And they just lost their following in San Francisco.
Right.
And, you know, why take a chance in L.A. when we have a good following in the Bay Area and we could make some noise up there?
I hear you. Well, we'll talk more in a little bit. We're going to play some videos right now. We got some good friends of yours, in fact. Skid Row.
All right, cool.
The ball continues on through the night. We got Ashley and Davey from Vane with us in the studio. We're going to roll your brand new video in a second.
Great.
Producing, you've produced some things in the past, haven't
yeah.
you?
I produced two albums for a really heavy thrash band called Death Angel.
Mm-hmm.
And I produced about every demo tape from every thrash band in San Francisco.
Yeah.
That's how I stayed alive for the last 2 years. So yeah, I'm really, and I co-produced our album.
I was going to say, because you were no stranger to producing, so you... So when you went in, of course, you'd done other demos, other bands. Was it hard to do your own
It was the
record?
Hardest ever. It was just like, I was in there pulling my hair out the whole time. So we had a producer, Paul Northfield,
mm-hmm.
Was, you know, the main producer, and he kind of had the final say. But it's just like, I was so worried about every detail, everything. We did the record almost completely live, so it's hard to make it, you know, sound really big with just like one take of everything,
mm-hmm.
you know, everyone playing together and just going, okay, that's it, one guitar left, one guitar right, me singing with the band, we listen to it and go, okay, that's it, what are we gonna do now?
It's right.
like, so it's just like, and I wanted all the vocals to sound right, I didn't want anything to sound too big or too dated, or, because I'd done a lot of tricks in the past with thrash bands where I made the background vocals to sound like anthems, and
right.
I wanted to sound real, I wanted to sound just like Vane live and keeping the energy, so it was definitely a lot harder than producing someone else. You can make a decision much quicker when you produce someone else going, yeah, that's great, no problem, let's move on, but when it's yourself, you go, I can do it better.
And he drove us all night.
I was just going to say, tell me, how was he as a producer?
Oh, it was crazy because he'd have to make sure that everybody was happy with, you know, what was coming out
mm-hmm.
on tape. And, you know, he'd be running around, oh, is it good enough? You know, do you think it's too much this? Do you think it's too much that? Oh, no. What do you think? And then, you know, it was just like driving us nuts.
But nobody fights broke out.
No fights.
No fights.
I have almost too much of Dipland. I don't like it. I feel bad if, like, even one member of the band was just going, I think it's cool, but I don't dig it. Then I'd feel like my mission was to have it sound. Like, I wanted to sound, have the band happy, the producer happy, just have everything great. And it's hard to do that with a record.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like getting, you know, five guys and a different guy to give them all a paintbrush and go paint that. You know, that's what recording is. You know?
But he did a good job. We're proud of him. So. Yeah.
Well, actually, we're going to check out some of the product right now. We got the video. Beat the Bullet. Anything you want to say quickly about the video before we lead into it?
It's done in San Francisco. All the outside shots are done right outside Broadway, where we play in the Stone. And the two snakes in it are a couple of my pets, Cleo and Caesar. So.
And they're with you on the tour bus, in fact.
No, Spot is.
Oh, Spot. Okay.
They're back home. They're two biggest stars. They need their own bus. You know, they won't share a bus with any crew members.
Here we go. This is Vane. Beat the Bullet. Back, we still have Ashley and Davey here from Vane, and I gotta tell you, when these guys walked in, all of a sudden I heard a language which I recognized. You were speaking Dutch to me, which is like so crazy. Now, your parents are originally from Holland?
Yeah, my mom. She's actually a singer in Holland.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and she toured you know, all through Europe, and my dad met her over there, saw her singing, then she moved back over here and gave up the career. And
I'm telling you, Dutch girls do rule.
Yeah, they're happening.
I know firsthand.
Yeah.
Dus we zouden gewoon iets in het Nederlands kunnen zeggen en het maakt niet uit en niemand zou het begrijpen.
Yeah, niemand weet wat we zeggen, you know.
Yeah. That was about your tour manager over there.
Yeah.
So, speaking of touring, you guys are going out with Skid Row?
In Europe, or in England, we're mm-hmm. playing. Right now, we're headlining our own club tour, mm-hmm. and then in about 2 weeks, we're heading over there and playing with them. We're really excited about it because we think like we're probably one of our favorite new bands, and mm-hmm. haven't come out in a long time.
Just a word of advice: if Sebastian starts to ramble, just tell him to shut up. He won't mind.
Okay. You know,
it's just like
I have a feeling Davey can keep up with him. So
I've got a big mouth too. You know?
All right. Well, it was good having you guys here. Thanks a lot for dropping by.
Man.
Good luck. We'll see you
thanks
soon.
Thanks for having us.
When you're in the area, just come on by.
All right, man. Okay.
We're going to close off now with the debut from the new Bad Brains album, Quickness. This is Soulcraft.
Hello, you rotten little bloodsuckers. Alice Cooper here. Welcome to my nightmare. Welcome to my house, and welcome to a truly shocking Halloween edition of Headbangers Ball. Tonight I'll be playing chilling videos from masters of metal like Ozzy Osbourne, Motley Crue, Danzig, and Dokken, to name a few. Maybe even a few of my own videos. Stopping by on this night of trick-or-treat, where I have everything to give them, are some bands who'll appear in the Shocker soundtrack album. Dave Mustaine from Megadeth, the guys from Dangerous Toys, and of course, Iggy Pop. And best of all, we'll meet the lucky winner of MTV's Shock Treatment Contest. This will be a Hallows Eve to end all Hallows Eve. And what better place to start it all off than a haunted castle in Great Britain with Black Sabbath. Welcome to a special Halloween edition of Headbangers Ball. Oh, it's probably one of those horrible little children. Oh, Dave Mustaine from Megadeth, my best pals. He did one of my old songs, and I'm so proud that he did one of my songs for the Shocker. But I have something better than candy for you. This goes with the song. I've worn it for years. I want to pass it down to its rightful owner now.
Thanks.
Oh, it's just your size, too. That's great.
We'll see about that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I like that. Fits great.
Help me.
No, you do it. You can do it yourself. You'll learn how to do it yourself.
This next video is called No More Mr. Nice Guy.
No more Mr. Nice Guy.
I'm Alice Cooper. This is my house. This is Halloween. This is Headbangers Ball. And this is my first trick-or-treater of the night, Dave Mustaine. Dave, what's the most shocking thing that's ever happened to you?
Well, last year, you put me in the electric chair for Halloween. This year, I got a straitjacket on. What next, the guillotine?
The guillotine. There's a few tricks and some musical treats coming up. Right now, here's Quiet Riot. Mental health. Looks good on you, Dave. It's a haunted, hellacious headbanger's ball. More children. I hate this. It's Jason and Mike.
What's up, man?
Hey. You guys look like you've been on the road.
Yeah, we have.
Oh, I have special prizes for you guys for trick-or-treat.
Good.
Dangerous toys deserve. Dangerous toys.
My favorite kind.
For you, Jason.
Right.
Now be careful. Don't put your eye out. These are for the guys that didn't make it.
All right.
There you go.
Give this one to Scott.
It's for your girlfriend.
Ooh, yeah. She'll appreciate these.
You know, I have such fond memories of Halloween. When I was a child, we used to sit around with all the other little children and open our presents and watch the tree burn. What did you guys do for Halloween?
Well, every year I used to dress up like Gene Simmons and spit blood on everything and everyone.
How romantic. What about you, Mike?
I used to take little strolls through graveyards, like about 3 o'clock in the morning.
I do that every night. Well, coming up next hour is a man who will haunt your dreams forever. Once you've seen him in action, his name is Horace Pinker, and he follows in the ghoulish footsteps of Jason, Leatherface, Michael Myers, and Freddy Krueger. Speaking of Freddy, here's Nightmare from Dokken. I'm Alice Cooper, and it's a special Halloween edition of Headbangers Ball with my good friends Jason and Michael, two appropriate names for Halloween. Tell me something about your clowns.
This clown, his name is Bill Z. Bub, and he's very scary. And when I was growing up, I wasn't particularly a fan of clowns. They were very scary to me. They were almost, I don't know what the word is. They had these really huge feet, these big, ugly red noses, and they were just scary to me.
And now they're all in the Senate. Isn't that great?
That's right.
Right now, it's Overkill. Look out for their bat mascot, Charlie, in this one.
Happy Halloween, headbangers. There's more spine-tingling metal on the way from Annihilator. Kiss. And Ozzy Osbourne for some electrifying guests, so don't touch that dial. Unless you're scared. See you on TV, huh?
It's a Headbangers Halloween with me, Alice, and...
Hi, Mr. Cooper.
It's Iggy.
Trick or treat.
Iggy always comes around because I have his favorite treat.
Well, give me some of it.
I got it right here.
Come on, give it to me.
Ooh. But first, we're going to play one of your videos.
Oh, no. Let's see your video, Mr. Cooper.
No. We'll play one of your videos.
No. I want to see one of yours.
Well, all right. I think he's right. Let's show one of mine. Poison. There you go.
buddy. I'm the state of the art, got a brain a la carte. I make the babies cry. I ain't one of the crowd, I ain't one of the guys. They just avoid me, they run and they hide. All my colors are bright, all my eyes set too wide. I spent my whole life burning, turning. I'm a teenage Frankenstein, the local freak with a twisted mind. I'm a teenage Frankenstein. These ain't my hands and these legs ain't mine. Got a synthetic face, got some scars and a brace. My hands are rough and bloody. I walk into the night, women faint at the sight. I ain't no cutie pie. I can't walk in the day, I must walk in the night. Stay in the shadow, stay out of the light. My soul is divine, keep my head screwed on tight. I spent my whole life burning, turning. I'm a teenage Frankenstein, the local freak with the twisted mind. I'm a teenage Frankenstein. These ain't my arms and these legs ain't mine, no.
It's a special Halloween edition of Headbangers Ball with me, Alice Cooper, and one of my very best friends of all time, Iggy. You certainly are enjoying that, aren't you?
It's form free.
Oh, it is. It's very good. You do that very well. Who is your favorite scary person in all movies? Well, who's your favorite scary person?
Right now, I like that General Noriega.
Oh, he's a scary guy.
I really like him. His old Bush wants to get in there and get him. He can't get him, can he? Ah,
you know, he's all scarred up.
All your soldiers and your advisors from the country club, you can't get him. He's got the beautiful scars on his face.
I know.
Yeah, well, macho, you know, come and get me. Oh, yeah.
He's a good guy,
he's
I know.
He's a good guy.
I kind of lean towards Zsa Zsa at this point.
Zsa Zsa,
he's a scary,
really
scary,
too,
scary. And what about Horace Pinker? Ooh, Horace.
I know, I saw him on TV last night. No more Mr. Nice Guy.
A mean guy. He may be coming in later, and I'm going to try to avoid him because the guy is a very dangerous guy. Some lucky viewer is going to meet the Shocker and give him their own personal hit list. Ooh, I hope I'm not on. It's a special Halloween revenge gift from all of us to one of you. Right now, it's a touching sentiment from Glenn Danzig. Mother. Oh.
It's a Headbangers Halloween.
Yeah, and Alice is out there right now ripping off some trick-or-treaters.
So what about this cold metal, Iggy?
Oh, I don't know, Dave. What about this speed metal?
You tell me.
Hell, I don't know. Let's ask Zed Yago.
Blackbone Song.
All right.
Headbangers Halloween. In a few minutes, we'll meet the winner of MTV's Shock Treatment Contest. And be sure to watch Headbangers Ball this Saturday to see the second video from the Shocker soundtrack. Bonfire, Sword, and Stone. Here's a look right now. Now, here's Ozzy. Well, headbangers, it's been an evening to warm your heart and chill your soul.
You're dead meat, Cooper.
What's the matter, Horace? Don't like my new pinker-proof jacket? Get him, guys!
No, not he's...
Well, Halloween is just about over, so let's meet the winner of MTV's Shock Treatment Contest, Kim Kreutzer. Kim, I'd introduce you to Horace, but he's a little nervous right now, if you don't mind. Let's watch Halloween with Halloween.